Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Open Network User Group Podcast. I'm Mark Tierney. I'm ONUG CTO. Today, we dive into an exciting innovation that's revolutionizing the way enterprises connect and communicate, private 5G. And in the era of digital transformation, enterprises are constantly seeking ways to optimize their operations, enhance productivity, stay ahead of the competition. And one technology that's gaining some attention is private 5G. But what exactly is private 5G? Why is it so important for the enterprise? We're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about it with an industry expert. But first, ONUG Fall 2023, it's going to be a hybrid event again, but the in-person, the in-person in Dallas, the spring 2023 conference was on fire. Fall is going to be even better in New York City at the Chelsea Industrial Event Center. It's October 24th and 25th. Come join us and join the ONUG community of global 2,000 companies, tech execs, enterprise architects, infrastructure engineers, cloud providers, thought leaders, as we discuss and demonstrate the tenets of enterprise cloud, networking, security, policy management. The list goes on. Go to ONUG.net to register for this event today. You can use the promo code ONUG Podcast and we'll give you a 20% discount. Don't forget, share, like, subscribe, whatever platform you're on, share this with your associates, your friends, and your enemies. We don't care. Just share it. Get out there. All right. Today, joining me on today's podcast, my special guest is Stephen Collins. He is my partner in crime at ONUG. He is the ONUG Service Provider CTO. And Steve, welcome to the podcast today, buddy.
Hey, great to be here. Thanks, Mark. Appreciate it.
So we just came off of ONUG Spring, and you were front and center on the main stage talking about 5G. So that's what I want to do. I want to dig into this area where, I mean, clearly you're a subject matter expert, and there's so much energy, but we're going to need to sort this out, right? A little bit, Stephen, like what is and why is 5G game changing? Is it really? And, you know, let's start there. And just for our audience sake, we're going to draw attention to Stephen has written a blog series on ONUG.net under our blog page about this topic. We're kind of follow along with that progression. So you'll be able to go to the blogs as well and get some really deep insight. But we want to hear it from Steve because he is an industry expert. All right. So Steve, what is 5G? What is private 5G? And, you know, why is it game changing right now?
Yeah. So I think there's a couple of threads here that we want to separate. There's kind of 5G as a, you know, next generation cellular technology. And that in and of itself is actually going to be game changing. So, I'm going to touch on the reasons why. But then there's private 5G networks. So in the context of an enterprise environment, I think specifically that's going to be very game changing. And the reason for that is, you know, if you look at what's going on in the enterprise networks today, wireless connectivity for most enterprises means Wi-Fi, right? And it usually just means laptops, tablets, you know, maybe various types of consumer grade devices that are Wi-Fi ready. It has also been deployed in kind of operational environments as well. I don't want to sell that technology short, but, you know, that's been kind of what's been available if you wanted to do some sort of wireless connectivity. In the IoT space, there are wireless technologies that have been specifically designed for kind of low power, long range, wide area coverage for kind of very simple devices, you know, sensors and actuators that need to be reached. You know, if you think about an agricultural environment where you're trying to put devices that are monitoring crops or something like that. So there's that type of wireless connectivity. That's kind of a niche market in some respects today. But if you really look at what's going on with 5G, you know, when 5G was conceived, which goes back, you know, 10 to 15 years ago, you know, what primarily drives these generations in the wireless world is just improved radio technologies. They just figure out how to put, you know, more bits over the given amount of bandwidth, right? So 5G's got some breakthroughs, you know, in terms of how that's done, some new technologies built in called things like massive MIMO and beamforming. You know, everything just makes the radio network work better. But the interesting thing that happened with 5G is like, okay, we can make this thing work better. And specifically, we can make it run really fast and we can make it run with really low latency. You know, who's really going to need that? and there are use cases for consumers where consumers want, you know, gigabit connectivity and ultra low latency. But if you really think who the real customer for that is, that's really going to be the enterprise. So, you know, there's a lot of kind of backlash on 5G in the sense that, you know, I got a 5G phone, you know, it's better than my LTE phone, but it's, you know, it's not kind of changing my world. But I think from an enterprise perspective, when we get full-blown 5G networks out there that are not connected to the 4G core, like the radios are in most networks today, but are instead connected to the 5G core, a cloud-native 5G core, we're going to see a whole set of new capabilities that just don't exist in the wireless realm today.
Steven, it's interesting the way you're saying this because I many of us in digital transformation programs over the years, especially recently, have been saying, wow, you know, the consumerization of technology has changed the game for the enterprise. Our expectations have gone up, right? In other words, as consumers inside of our own enterprises, we're constantly wondering, you know, hey, I could do this on my phone for my personal apps. Why can't I get the same kind of experience, you know, in the workplace? And, you know, it's driven things like, customer experience and customer satisfaction from an employee perspective. I'm hearing you say we're flipping the model a little bit. Like maybe now, we've got an emergent technology where the enterprise, you know, may potentially be driving innovation and change as opposed to the other way around on the consumers. I don't know that that's true, but well, it would be kind of cool.
No, that's an interesting observation because I think that's actually true with 5G. I mean, I think for the vast majority of mobile users who use the phones the way we all use them today, you know, 4G networks are actually pretty good. When you get to 5G, they are better. You know, if you're going to watch 4K video, you're going to want to do that on a 5G network and not on a 4G network. But, you know, again, if you're kind of cutting out some of those super high bandwidth applications, you know, 4G has been pretty good. So why would people, you know, adopt 5G? I think it'll get adopted more widely by the enterprise community because you've got digital transformation, you've got robotics, you've got highly mobile machinery, right? Right. You've got drones and autonomous vehicles or guided vehicles, you know, they call them AGVs, autonomous guided vehicles. You've got a lot of use cases in the enterprise where things need to be connected wirelessly, yet they're going to be highly mobile. And highly mobile is, I think, what differentiates sort of the 5G cellular technology from the Wi-Fi technology. You know, Wi-Fi can do mobile, but cellular has been doing mobile a lot longer than Wi-Fi networks. So that's what I think is going to make 5G attractive to the enterprise. Also, the whole low latency aspect of it. If you're trying to do stuff where you really need to be operating in near real time, you know, some type of telemetry data that you're collecting so you can be reactive and particularly take an action with some sort of a remote device, you're going to want to do that with a very low latency connection. So
you brushed up against it a little bit. We're talking about IoT use cases. When my brain immediately goes, just because I have a little bit of experience in space, in the smart city, smart campus, smart building, right, this type of environment, there's a strong government overlay on this, where you know potentially, you know, we talk about the enterprise tend to think about enterprise, you know, business consumers, but there's a strong government consumption side of this technology as well. Is that fair? I'm putting you on the spot a little bit.
No, they're just one of many verticals that I think are going to adopt 5G. Yeah, that whole smart XYZ space, you know, 5G is an ideal connectivity technology. And that's been sort of a commonly touted set of use cases for 5G, right? You know, smart cities or smart buildings to a lesser extent. Although personally, I actually think kind of the building thing is maybe overlooked today. People are not necessarily as attuned because I think they think buildings, Wi-Fi, well, we're going to be okay. But again, what's going to differentiate, I think, 5G from 4G is I think you'll see 5G connectivity built into more and more devices that are going to need to be mobile. Now, mobile could be, like I just talked about, devices that actually do move around, or devices like medical equipment that gets moved around. And I think increasingly that equipment will actually have 5G either built into it or sort of a 5G connectivity module, you know, stuck on the side.
Just all right, because so let me
Yeah.
Let me stop.
Right.
Let me stop you on that one, because that's an interesting one where, if on the one hand, and I'll just disclose my bias up front. So as you know, I manage the working groups at ONUG.
Right.
And one of our working groups is the hyperautomation working group. And we have a couple members of that working group that are in the pharmaceutical business.
Right.
And one of the reasons why hyperautomation, this marriage of AI ops and orchestration automation tools, is so important is for the reasons you're talking about. What can and should I be doing from an AI ops automation perspective to help robotics on a pharmaceutical floor?
Right.
That sort of thing. So now what I'm hearing you say is 5G, enterprise 5G may provide something more specifically valuable to the business than just Wi-Fi. So I want to put you on the spot.
Yeah,
Can we unpack that a little bit?
Yeah. So the really key thing, the reason I picked kind of medical device equipment that's mobile, is first of all, 5G is more secure than LTE. And the goal is to make it even more secure than what we do with Wi-Fi. You know, it doesn't use the same kind of security and authentication mechanisms as Wi-Fi, but it also operates in both shared spectrum, the CBRS spectrum, but more importantly, it can operate in licensed spectrum. You know, and licensed spectrum, you know, is not shared, right? And you know, to a large extent, it's kind of carefully managed, right, in terms of who's utilizing it. So the idea being, if you've got a piece of equipment that needs wireless connectivity and you just want to make sure the wireless connectivity is there, whether that's over a public network or over a private network, I think 5G is going to become the choice. And so I think the more mission critical the devices are, the more likely they're going to have 5G connectivity built into them. The more, you know, kind of utilitarian the devices are, I think those will keep Wi-Fi, because Wi-Fi is certainly going to get better. We got Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 7. It's not like they're standing still. And I don't think you're going to see 5G as a built-in, for instance, in the majority of laptops. I think, you know, first of all, you can tether those to your phone. That'll probably be the more common mode of connectivity. But, you know, it's not necessarily a need to build that in. But if you've got a piece of, you know, sort of mission critical equipment, whether that's in a manufacturing environment, medical environment, some sort of smart city type of environment, I think increasingly you're going to see 5G built into those devices.
All right. So I have to ask, because when you brought up licensed, you know, wavelengths potentially, right? So is this added complexity on top of the flexibility and value? Like, are we going to complicate our world in this regard? And if, you know, if so, is that just a good and necessary trade-off for, you know, getting the additional business value?
I think that's a good point. So I think, you know, the great thing about Wi-Fi is it is pretty simple. I mean, once you do the proper, you know, network design and planning for your Wi-Fi network, and there are people that specialize in that, you know, you put up the access points and you've got the connectivity. And, you know, when you get dead spots, you can fiddle around with it and sort that out pretty quickly. 5G is different than that, right? I mean, first of all, 5G doesn't operate just in, you know, a couple of spectrum bands like Wi-Fi does. 5G can operate in the low frequency bands, what they call low band, which is sort of what most of the phones use today on the 4G network. Then they operate in these mid bands, which are around 3.5 gigahertz. And then they can operate in these high bands, which are up around, you know, 28 gigahertz and a little above that, and a little bit below that. And they can even eventually, I think, operate up as high as 60 gigahertz. But you've got different spectrum bands. You've got spectrum that's shared, sort of like the Wi-Fi model, although it's the CBRS model is more strict than that. And then you've got, you know, licensed spectrum that, you know, big operators go off and buy at auction, right? And they can lease that spectrum back to the enterprise, you know, who wants to use it. So, yeah, 5G is more complex. I mean, just the spectrum issues alone make it more complex. You know, the radio equipment, the core network that supports that radio equipment, that's more complex. You know, it's definitely not sort of a plug and play technology. And I think in my most one of my most recent blog posts, I talked about the different types of partners that enterprises will want to work with to kind of take them along on their enterprise 5G or private 5G journey. And there's plenty of capable outfits, you know, that are there to kind of partner with the enterprise. It'd be crazy for anybody to do it on their own. Let me put it that way.
Is that right? Okay. So that's good to hear. I mean, that's good to know. I'll say this. I'm a little old school, maybe a little older school than you, not by much. Let's just say not by much, Stephen. But you know, it makes me think a little bit of the old days of, inter-building microwave, you know, some enterprises would do back in the day. Yeah. And yeah, you could do that on your own.
I worked on one of those projects back at Bell Labs in 1986.
Right.
See, believe it or not.
Yeah. So we get it. Like we get it. And you can do that by yourself, but it's not easy, right? Yeah. You got to jump through a few hoops. So, but I mean, you're the ONUG Service Provider CTO for a reason. I'm assuming that you're seeing the service providers, they're going to fill the gap here on this type of stuff. Is that fair? Are they still figuring it out?
No, I think the service providers, you know, first and foremost, look at the private 4G networks that are out there today. You know, the vast majority of those networks have been deployed either by the large service providers, and this is globally, you know, the big top tier one mobile operators around the world, or their suppliers, right? Because, I mean, the top tier operators, they use the equipment from those suppliers, and the suppliers all have sort of a private network practice as well, where they can go in and put up their equipment and, you know, either the spectrum's available or it can be licensed, but it's largely kind of a service provider game today if you want to build a private 4G network. And those are sort of in obvious places where, yeah, okay, I need to do cellular connectivity, but you know, there's no public network. So there's a mining operations, utility networks, transportation facilities, whether that's an airport or a shipping hub, oil and gas drilling operations, you know, places that are out in kind of the middle of the ocean or, you know, the middle of the jungle or the desert, what have you. So there's a lot of private 4G networks out there already, kind of in the obvious industry verticals. And largely being served by either the big operators directly or the equipment providers that sell to those operators. When we look at private 5G, those players will be front and center again. I mean, I think, you know, to a great extent, they'll be front and center. But what makes it different is this. You're not just like talking about just, hey, I need to have phone connectivity or I want to have some special tablets have connectivity. It's going to be, I'm trying to hook up my entire manufacturing operation, put that on wireless connectivity, or I'm trying to run a fleet of drones, or I've got these new sophisticated IoT devices all over the place. So you're going to have to bring in enterprise system integrator types and industry specific sort of solution providers who are going to pull all of that together in the full stack, you know, on top of the private 5G network. So it's actually going to be a broader set of players, because those kind of vertically integrated players, they may or may not have the chops to kind of pull off everything in the 5G network. You know, more likely they're going to kind of bring in partners, you know, to provide that specific layer, the private 5G network layer.
I have to believe, so I'm going to put myself out on a limb and you smack me down here, but I have to believe the hypers are going to be leading the charge on some of this. I have to believe that AWS's, Google's, Microsoft, you know, these folks that have you know, large data centers, large distribution environments, picking packages off shelves or repairing equipment in a rack, you know, whatever it is. Are they the leading consumers for this sort of thing?
I don't know if they're the leading consumers, but they're definitely leading players. I mean, AWS has already announced a private 4G, private 5G service that a managed service that they'll deliver. And so they run the core software in the cloud. You know, they put radios on premise. They, you know, get everything connected. They work with subcontractors who can do some of the RF design and planning. You know, Microsoft is a big player in cloud-based software for telcos. I mean, they have a you know, publicly announced relationship with AT&T along those lines. And Google's kind of, I think, will tend to do the same sort of thing at a minimum of what Microsoft is doing, you know, running telco software in the cloud. And who knows, they may go as far as what Amazon's doing. I have no visibility into that. But the edge computing part of it plays into this as well, right? So taking that kind of near cloud edge And that could actually host some of the radio functions, you know, the radio functions using the disaggregated Open RAN or VRAN model. You know, you've got the radio units can be distributed, but the sort of underlying baseband processing software can run kind of on an open compute platform, like right there at the edge. And you're going to see that sort of thing going on as well. That's what makes it kind of complex. There's a lot of different moving parts. And the most important thing I think to remember about the complexity is it's just going to be different depending on industry vertical and specific type of use case. In other words, what you do for a large scale manufacturing operation may look different than what you do for a big kind of massive in-building campus coverage application, which might look different from what you do in a big outdoor environment, you know, maybe a big oil and gas and drilling operation or mining operation, different types of radios, you know, different types of devices, different spectrum bands, and then a whole array of use cases, whether that's, you know, machines talking to machines or some of it could be people talking to people. You know, it's really important to kind of do the right type of planning up front. So you're on the right path to success.
Yeah, I love that you led me right where I wanted to go, which is, you know, anytime we're doing new technology, I've got to buy some new thing, Stephen. Right? It is what it is, and I've got two different conversations, and this is how I always describe it to people. You got the conversation you're having for the advocate inside the enterprise who wants the stuff, right? They're the practical people that have to implement, and they know they're going to get some value out of it. And then you're having that conversation with the CIO and the CFO and explaining why, you know, what's the business value, and it better line up with cost, time to market, enhanced security, customer experience, or delivering some competitive business value. And what I just heard you say was, it could be on any of those things. The value prop on 5G could line up with any of those traditional stories that we need to tell, right? As technologists to our to the C-suite, why we're doing something. So, on the other hand, I don't see this as a huge cost reduction opportunity, but maybe I'm wrong. Do you see private 5G driving costs down at all, or just adding value?
Well, it depends on the deployment model, right? I think if you're going to put equipment on premise, right, which you could have one deployment model, which all the radios are on premise, all the core network software functions are in a data center on premise, you know, that costs capital to do that. But there's another model, which is you can run the entire private 5G network off of what's called the network slice that's provided by the public network operator. And you basically have nothing on premise. Yeah. And so, you know, there's two extreme models right there. And then there's hybrid models where some stuff could be on premise, some stuff could live in the cloud. That cloud could be a cloud provider like a Microsoft or an AWS, or it could be that, you know, the mobile operator's telco cloud. So, you know, the cost side of the equation kind of varies, right? Just depending on what the model is. I think some users will require everything on premise. You know, nothing is going to be off premise. Even the 5G core software, they'd be, nope, we're going to run that on premise. It's got to be locked down. And other people would say, if I don't even have to have the radios on premise, I'm happy. If I could run this just off of a slice, off of the public network, assuming there's enough capacity in the public network, I'd be happy to just run it in the public network.
Haven't we had this argument already? I mean, organizations are like, I can't go to the cloud. I can't take this application to the cloud. I can't take that application to the cloud. And everybody's like, yeah, you can. You can take it all there.
I think this will be driven a little bit more by performance requirements, latency requirements, and security requirements. I think the security thing will drive how much is on-prem, because you're only going to put stuff off-prem to the extent you're comfortable that it's secure. The performance requirement will be a function of, well, I could run that in the public network. I mean, you know, yeah, they're going to give me the bandwidth. The latency isn't quite as critical. And, you know, I don't have to put up any radios on-prem. You know, the Verizon or AT&T told me they've got a tower like right there. And, you know, it's not like we have football games going on Sunday afternoon right next door or something like that. So, you know, that's why I actually believe the service providers will kind of be front and center in this, because they might come along and say, we can help you build it on premise, or we could help you just run it off of our public network with this technology called network slicing. Now, be clear though, the network slicing thing, we're not there yet, because to do network slicing, you actually do need that cloud native 5G core. You can't really run the network slicing thing the way it should be run off of the existing 4G core. It just wasn't engineered to do that. But once those cloud native 5G cores go into place, then I think you'll see a lot more private networking actually taking place off the public network.
Nice. All right. I don't want to go too deep into this. You did do one of your blogs is about kind of what the private 5G universe looks like today.
Right.
Without going into a ton of detail, are there like emergent players that we wouldn't expect? Maybe, you know, shine the spotlight on something that might be a bit surprising, if anything, to us in terms of what the 5G universe looks like.
Yeah, so I think what's interesting about it, there's two key sets of players. There's I kind of lumped them into sort of solutions and service providers, right? So these are the people that aren't necessarily building equipment and things like that. They're coming in delivering you a service or delivering you a solution. And then there's all the folks building the underlying systems and software. Now, sometimes the service and solutions providers also do the systems and software, but you got to figure out what hat they're wearing when they're talking to you. I think where it's interesting is in both areas, you've got new types of players. So on the services and solutions front, the folks that have been building like Wi-Fi networks are going to get into building private 5G networks. You know, it's sort of like a natural progression for them. You know, they've already got some of the expertise. They understand things like spectrum and RF design and planning. So I think you're going to see players moving, not moving away from Wi-Fi, but augmenting their Wi-Fi business with like a private 5G business. Similarly, the folks that build Wi-Fi radio equipment, I think you're going to see some of them building private, 5G and even private 4G radio equipment. I think that's going to be a logical progression. And you're already seeing some of that, but there's also a whole host of vendors building more compact 5G radios. The term the telco industry uses is small cells. You know, they're sort of compact radios. They can be deployed indoor environments, but they can be deployed in outdoor environments as well. But, you know, this isn't the technology that goes up on the tower, right? This is the technology that's more, building and structure based. And there's a whole host of vendors building those radio systems. And I think I list a few in the blog, but that's a very active place because you don't need the same power that you need on the tower. Some of them will have the sophisticated, massive MIMO and beamforming capabilities. Others might not, because you might just put it in a room. And if it's in a room, it's only servicing the people that are in that room. So you don't need some super sophisticated antenna technology to cover the people in the room. So there's a lot going on and a lot of moving parts again in terms of who the different players are.
Nice. All right. Help me understand, help the audience understand what should enterprises be doing right now? Like if I need to explore, I need to start understanding, I need to start formulating, business cases, use cases around this. More often than not, some C-level is going to come to some director or VP and go, why aren't we looking at this? Are we looking at this? What's your advice to those people in the enterprises, the architects and engineers? What should they be doing right now?
Yeah, I think it has to be like a collaborative effort between the folks that are looking over the horizon for the business, because it's all driven by where is the business going. So if you're in a manufacturing intensive environment, I got to believe those folks are already looking at what are we doing about, industrial automation? What are we doing about, kind of smart, I just call them smart machines. They could be robots. Some of it actually could just be, video cameras, capturing video, doing AI processing, image processing on video that you're capturing. But imagine if those video cameras are mobile, and they're either on a drone or they're on some kind of autonomous vehicle or on some type of a robot. It's all really going to be based off what are the business needs. It's all falls under that umbrella of digital transformation, but digital transformation always boils down to specific projects, right? Specific initiatives. And so I think every business has to look forward and say, okay, what are we doing where wireless connectivity is going to be kind of a key requirement? And then what are the critical set of use cases we think are really important for the business? There may be others going forward, but what are the ones that like we have to tackle these? And then use that to kind of drive towards a specific, you know, either public enterprise 5G strategy or a private, you know, 5G strategy. Because some things you'll just be able to do on the public network. We don't necessarily have to put up a private 5G network. But there's other use cases where, yeah, you're going to have to put up a private 5G network to do
it. What I'm hearing you say is the real challenge is potentially looking, you said, look for those applications where, you know, where wireless is important. But I think what I'm really hearing you say is look where wireless could or should be. Like it may, in other words, because of the lack of capabilities in Wi-Fi today,
right?
You're not using it,
right?
Where are those future capabilities? Challenge yourself. Your architectural teams, your engineering teams should be challenging themselves to look at this technology and figure out if there's a brand new opportunity for you inside your enterprise to deliver value in one of those areas I was talking about: cost, time to market, business experience, customer experience, employee experience.
And I think the thought experiment is like, just pretend wireless connectivity isn't an issue. Let's just assume if it was there and it was there at high performance and low latency and good security and great reliability, what could we do? Because then you can imagine a set of use cases, and then you can come back and say, okay, what does it take to make this fly? Now, some things in 5G that you might need are not there yet. There's some low latency capabilities where stuff has to be built into the device itself, you know, the chipset. And some of that isn't going to be kind of set in stone in terms of the standards until release 17 of the 3GPP specs or even release 18. So you kind of have to know what's going to become available when in terms of how hard you might be pushing the envelope. But there's a whole set of use cases you can do today with the existing technology as it is.
Excellent. All right. Will there be a private 5G working group in ONUG?
I have every expectation there will be. I mean, of course, it's all driven by kind of community demand. But when you consider kind of the set of possibilities and some of the underlying complexities, I think it would be, I guess I'd say it would be unwise not to have one. I mean, if nothing else, we could at least kind of get everybody into that virtual room and make sure everybody understands what the issues are, just as a starting point. Just get educated on what's going on from a technology perspective, what the different types of services and solution options are, who's who in the ecosystem. Because there are companies that have already done this with like private 4G, so they could come into the community and kind of, I look at them as being like village elders, right? They can help educate others. But I think every company that I've seen that's been involved in ONUG, somewhere enterprise 5G or private 5G is going to touch their business. I mean, I don't see how it could not do that.
Well, Stephen, we've come to the end of this episode, but I can't imagine anyone better than you to help lead those discussions. You've done so much already at both the ONUG Spring Conference and, you know, today on the podcast, as well as the blog series. Again, I'll invite everybody to go to ONUG.net, go to our content page, look at the blog link, and you'll see an entire series written by Stephen on this topic. Check those out, share it with your friends and associates and get some real insight, and then keep tabs on us. We'll certainly be letting the industry know and our community know, the ONUG membership know, when we stand up a 5G, private 5G working group. So that's great. On behalf of the ONUG Collaborative, Stephen, thank you for joining me today. And thanks everybody out there for listening. Go to ONUG.net. Don't forget, go to ONUG.net and register for ONUG Fall. It's already out there. You can already check it out. You can also go out to ONUG.net and look at the content from the Spring Conference. That's it. Stephen, thanks for joining me today, and we'll see everybody on the next ONUG podcast.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's been great.